contrast, she, as a result of defending herself against her attacker, was charged with GBH. Which is why, in the end, she was held on remand in a holiday prison. Now, the Sarah Reed for Justice campaign, which has just newly formed, and has the full support of the Reed family, and in the end, they're the ones who are going to have to take it forward. They're the ones who are going to have to fight for justice over 5, 10, 15, 20 years. We believe, because of the multitude of institutions that had a hand in the life and the death of this young 32-year-old woman, the police, the mental institutions, the prison, the court that remanded her in custody, the social workers, probation services, mental services, all of these, that Sarah Reed's case is a seminal turning point in public awareness in this country. In the same way that the Stephen Lawrence inquiry brought to the fore racism and institutionalized racism in this country. We believe that what is happening with Sarah, what happened to Sarah, will bring to light how black people are discriminated against, how women are discriminated against, how mentally ill people are maltreated in this country, and therefore it will be a turning point in public awareness and rights for all those oppressed groups in this country. We just hope and pray that the Reed family will have the strength to fight on all those fronts, and that they will not have to wait 20 years, as Dawn Lawrence did, for justice to be served. And that can only happen if we as women stand up, if we as trade unionists stand up, if we as black people stand together, as we in the community, as nurses, as, you know, as I'm sure there are public workers working in all these institutions who are appalled and horrified how people are treated. Yes, we can talk about the cuts, yes, we can talk about the job, but at the end of the day, we're talking about humanity. Humanity cannot be legislated for, and humanity cannot be trained into people. Either we see someone in front of us as someone who could be us, or we don't. That means we have to take, we have to control the narrative. We have to speak out whenever we see injustice. It doesn't matter who it's done to. Sarah Reed could have been your sister, your friend, your cousin. And as I said, as we go into this more and more, we're finding out the actual scale of the problem, that there are a lot more Sarah Reeds out there. And therefore, we have to do what we can through our organizations to prevent that happening. So what we'd like to appeal to you is not to say, well, this is somebody else. To actually take it on board, to say, this could have happened to someone I know. This could have happened to me. We're under a lot of pressure, women in the society, particularly in these hard economic times. We know that women are carrying, especially working women and women who can't find a job, are carrying the family. Carrying a lot, and the pressure is on. And as I said, you know, Marilyn, she came the second time we had another protest, was in support of the prisoners, because we had reason to believe that prisoners who saw what happened, who heard Sarah Reed screaming, they had evidence that they should and want to bring forward to the prison and Immigration Ombudsman, who are charged to investigate every death in custody, and that they were being intimidated to do so. So what we did, we organised a protest outside the prison in solidarity with the women prisoners, and we encouraged them to speak out, to disclose, and this is when I first met Marilyn. She was there, she was so strong. How she spoke out and said to the prisoners, you know, we know what's going on there, please disclose, help my daughter. We also wrote a letter, a public letter, which is up on our page, to the prison governor, stating our concerns. We also wrote to the prison and probation ombudsman, saying that we have reason to believe that the prisoners do not know about this inquiry, or they haven't been informed and are not being encouraged to disclose. We also wrote to Liberty, the Human Rights Justice Campaign. We've had a response from the governor of the prison, where she says, she thanked us for our concerns and said that as a result of us writing, she has reissued the notice to the prisoners. However, what we also know, in order for a prisoner to complain, she has to get pencil, paper, she has to be able to write, and then get it vetted through the prison office system. So the likelihood that that's going to be freely available, that information, we are highly concerned. And what is more, we learned yesterday at our campaign pen meeting that because Holloway is closing, women are being dispersed. So therefore, if they haven't, or if they don't give their evidence right now, the ability for us to track such women, so if any of you have any contacts with women in Holloway Prison, thank you, and can encourage women to speak out there about what they saw happened to Sarah Reed in her final day. The family weren't allowed to see the body for 3 days. Having been told to come to the prison because her daughter was dead, they were first told she strangled herself in her bed. I mean, it just gets worse. The mother actually described a broken jaw when she finally saw the body. We're still waiting for coroner's pictures to be released to the family. So, particularly if you have a society where you have a democratic society, where you do not have the death penalty, therefore any death in custody, without any recourse to justice or a trial, is a blot on the democratic and the criminal justice system in this country. It is really serious, and therefore, I'm speaking very slowly because it's very emotional for me as well. And I'm just sorry that Marilyn can't be here. I'd like to, I've been told to wind up, so that I can give a chance for people to speak.
I've also got Steve's
and
statement,
statement
to
read. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. We may still be joined by Marilyn, and if she does get here before we have to leave and go back to the conference, obviously we'll just slot her in the moment she arrives. But hopefully, you know, once she does get here, if she does get here, she'll be able to stay, and if you want to speak to her outside of the meeting. And to remind you that that's one of the emergency motions tomorrow is for My Union PCS, which is on supporting the Sarah Reed campaign. So I really appreciate it if people come in the debate and give their support from their unions. The TUC has just published a report today on a recent seminar that happened last month. Some of you may have attended it on equality and mental health. and that's the report, but it's available on the website now. It's on the TUC website. And what that report says, things that Patricia and I are very much aware of, is that it shows that mental health for black people is less likely to be detected by GPs. Black people are overrepresented in the criminal justice system, and they're impacted by institutional and structural racism and cultural stereotypes. I'd also like to bring your attention to Marilyn, so hopefully she's in the building, to the Morning Star, which is up here on display. But basically the Morning Star, if you haven't already picked up a copy from the stall downstairs, is got a special International Women's Day TUC Women's Conference 16-page supplement. And the whole 16-page supplement is dedicated to sisters of colour and written by black women. So I've written an article in there about what happened to Sarah. So if you want any of the details that's been mentioned by Patricia and myself, the article will give you that information. I'm going to read out Steve's statement, because even though Patricia and Marilyn may not hear all of it, I can share it with them afterwards in the interest of time. So Steve Gillen, the General Secretary